traditionally bill them for that type of contact? Do you, and this is kind of a general question, do you list who you met with, or is it just meeting and the date? I mean, how much specificity in your record keeping do you guys usually go through?
If I do my time sheets, I would know. I did one yesterday. I mean, I will be candid and be interesting and helpful. A typical time sheet for me is attend meeting with council office, raise such and such, or, you know, regarding such and such. I don't usually say, if I have a phone call with an individual, I mean that individual. But if I go to a meeting, I don't say meet with that. So, I mean, my time sheets would be, you know, they'd be 3 hours worth of work. I think that's why I said to characterize. And by the way, some of our compliance, and I'm going to pass along your kind words about Laura, and some of our compliance, Laura's checking the time records and looking for who the meetings were with. And you know, that's why I'm going to get 6 reports a year, because it's Laura doing 6 reports a year. But so I think the characterization of it goes to the purpose of the disclosure without creating a great opportunity for technical violations or burdensome.
When you schedule a meeting, and again, this question's very long, when you schedule a meeting, though, you know who you're scheduling the meeting with, right? It's just that if there is an instance where another person or another 2-3 people are added to the meeting, that in those particular instances, that's where it becomes difficult for you under our proposal to disclose, right? Well, if I'm understanding correctly.
Truth matters, I don't personally schedule most of the meetings either.
Yeah.
I schedule a meeting. Schedule a meeting with a council member. Odds are almost inevitably he or she will bring at least one, maybe two or three staff members.
And you might also schedule something with staff and that staff ends up not able to make it, but you meet with someone else instead. So it's,
and
yeah,
to
it's
go
not perfect.
To your previous question, I worked for a firm that did both hourly billing and monthly billing. Currently I do monthly. So I'm not billing somebody $5,000 for that meeting, $500 or whatever, you know, whatever you want to denote it to be. I'm billing somebody, whether I may have a meeting with every city council member this month and then next month, if I don't meet with any city council member, but two departmental staff, they're going to get billed very the same. Meetings out over time, as opposed to an hourly client where it's going to shift much more.
Yes.
Brad Hertz, just so we don't lose sight of the concern about compliance in terms of the 10-day turnaround, I was just reviewing my notes from the last meeting before the commission, and I know Donna Heinz from the Englander, Knobin and Allen firm I thought was particularly helpful in going through, you know, what a, I don't know if it's a Herculean task, but it's a substantial task to gather together the information, the contacts, to fill out the forms, and so 10 days, if you're trying to get compliance and you're trying to get accurate information, rushing it by only allowing for 10 days, I think is going to be counterproductive. In addition to adding more items that need to be disclosed, which will take more time, not less time. So most of our clients who are lobbyists and members of the association are definitely concerned that 10 days is going to put a very difficult burden on them, where it will make compliance more difficult and not more doable.
A number that was floated around from some of the comments of the last meeting was 15 days. Is that a more, is that an ideal number?
Very Solomonic.
What's that?
I'm very Solomonic.
What would be a,
I mean, obviously that's allows more days than 10. I think 30 days, certainly we looked at what the state, the county, the MTA, and most other jurisdictions do, and those are and that's 30 days. If 30 days is a non-starter because of what we talked about in terms of the public's need to know, I think 20 days would probably be doable. I mean, you have to think about weekends and holidays and folks who are away, especially where it's the very first part of the month. I can't speak for the entire regulated community, but if 30 wasn't going to work and 10 is too short, I think 20 might work.
And I'll just kind of throw into that, and to your point earlier about going from quarterly ability to buy monthly, I think there's much more heartburn about the timing you have to file versus the frequency. And so I think, you know, if you're proposing that you're saving 30 days by going to buy monthly, you don't necessarily need to go even further through also shortening this filing deadline and you know, leading to all of these issues that we've heard. I think that's much more challenging to meet that, again, with vacations and all of these different things that happen all the time, unpredictably. I think it's much more difficult to accommodate that than it is to accommodate more frequent filing.
I know there are firms, I mean, every firm is different, every practice is different. You will have some that, you know, the ones that are on top of it will try to, you know, fill out their things maybe every week or biweekly or at the end of the month, maybe it coincides with their billing of their client. When you all, again, a general question just so I can understand better, when you are filling out your reports, is it always, do you always start it at the end of the quarterly cycle? Do you ever input it before the end of the quarterly cycle, maybe monthly? I mean, how do you usually approach filling out those? Yes?
You can't start filling out how much money you've received in a quarter until that quarter's over.
Right. That's the problem.
So we can't do it when, you know, client gets billed.
That's the mismatch I was talking about.
Okay. One of the changes that was recommended in the proposal would be to report not the compensation not when it is received, but when it's when you become entitled to receive it. So that might make it easier if you know that I have this client and I engage in this amount of work for him and he's going to have to make this amount of money. If you're reporting it at that pace or at that place in the compensation timeline, then would that help?
Then would the client have to report when they receive the invoice?
Well, our clients in our jurisdiction do not.
Well, if a client is also a lobbyist employer, would they have to then report when they receive the invoice?
Well, I might not be following what you're saying. If you have a lobbyist employer, they wouldn't really be doing invoices for the lobbying work, right?
No, let's say I am a lobbyist employer, but I also have outside lobbying firm. Do I then list those lobbying firms down when I owe them money, when I receive an invoice?
Well, the lobbying firms that you have hired would be the ones to report that. So when they have engaged in work that entitles them to pay under the contract that they have with you, then they would have to report that.
But I would have to also report it on my CEC form for as a lobbyist employer.
As an expenditure?
Yeah.
Yes, that's true. That's
so
true.
When I'm invoiced or when I pay it?
You would, that's a good question. What did we decide about that? Expenditures. I think for expenditures, the difference is between it's one is money going out and one is money coming in.
Right.
For the money coming in, that was definitely talked about as being at the time that you become entitled to receive it. I don't think we have that same conversation with expenditures. So
right.
It would be when you have actually paid it in the month or in the reporting period.
Correct. However, with regard to, I believe that we were asking in this proposal not just for the expenses incurred, but also the money received as well. On top of the expenses that were also made.
And I can just say, as far as the timing, I'm sure everybody, Brad heard this again, I'm sure everybody has a different methodology. And, you know, we send out questionnaires usually every month to lobbying clients. Please, you know, keep us informed so we don't have to wait till the end of the year. As to, you know, what legislation or matters you're working on, what who have you contacted. You know, there's sometimes it's people wait and the squeaky wheel gets the grease. So, you know, there's other things that are further up on their to-do list. And, you know, we work really hard to get the information. And I'm sure they're working hard to get us the information. But if they're putting out other fires and, you know, that's why I think when you look at that 10-day window, you know, everyone can be working as hard as possible to try to comply within the 10 days, but as a practical matter, with your busy offices, it's not likely to happen.
From my own edification, how many of you solely partake in lobbying activity in the city of Los Angeles, or do you also, engage in lobbying activity in other jurisdictions, or your firm engage in lobbying activities in other jurisdictions, or even your client might have another lobbyist representative in another jurisdiction? Are all of you exclusive to the city of Los Angeles, or like San Diego, San Francisco, or some of the big cities you guys also
offer? Well, are you including Metro, LA County?
Yeah, that too, yeah.
I think probably everyone's at least those, as well as the city.
We work within cities around, not just the county, but around the region.
You know, one of the comments we got at the commission meeting was that our report is so much longer than other jurisdictions' reports. And even though I was able to look at the other reports, just at the reports themselves, it's hard to judge how much time it takes to do their reports because some of them have electronic filing systems and I don't have access to that. I know that many of you may not be the filers of the reports themselves, but does anybody have any experience with regard to the timing of how long it takes to file our reports in the city as opposed to, for example, Metro, County, San Diego, San Francisco?
It takes a lot longer.
Okay, are we talking electronic system versus electronic system?
Yes.
Is it the way the system is set up? Because
you guys ask for more information.
And when you say a lot, is it
three to four times as long?
Okay.
Yeah, 3 to 4 times as long than a state lobbying report or a metro lobbying report.
Do you feel like the reports in the other jurisdictions provide the public in those jurisdictions with adequate information about what's happening in the lobbying?
That's a judgment call. they provide less information.
Yeah.
And whether that information is useful or not, I don't know.
Another area in our proposals is including neighborhood councils in the definition of city agencies. I wanted to get a feel from you on how often, if any, or if at all, you do interact with neighborhood councils or know that that's a common practice. Do any of you do that? And how often is that a part of the process for you?
In our case, it's usually once or twice for every project. But we work on projects that get neighborhood councils.
And generally speaking, in those interactions, what does that include? Is that just kind of showing up in the meetings, contacting, what are we talking about?
It involves every communication in at least 9-point type disclosing on the registered. Which, by the way, I wonder why you don't have to say that out loud.
Yeah.
If I were writing that, I wouldn't have to say it out loud. I'm sorry, I was having so much fun, I forgot your question.
Just how extensive is that type
also, of thing? Honestly, it's usually a preparation meeting and talking with consultants and the client and usually preparing some reviewing some presentation materials. And neighborhood council meetings are long, so 5 hours, just as a guesstimate.
And that's not 5 hours of presentation, that's 5 hours waiting for your half-hour worth.
Yeah, but also the prep and getting ready.
Right. And for my neighborhood councils are infrequent, except on development projects. And that's mostly scheduling, answering, some basic questions. How would you like the information presented? What do you want? How long do we get? That sort of thing. That's not typically what, very rarely is that associated with what you consider lobbying.
And did you say CC also does that once in a while?
Yeah, I think probably where it differs is it's more like public comment type thing. So, showing up to say, we support this project for this or that reason, that kind of thing. And that's, irregular. It's not common, but it's.
Just out of curiosity, for development projects, is there a general sense that you need a neighborhood council's buy-in for it to go anywhere?
Yes.
Yeah.
We're happy when we get to the neutral.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I mean, because I believe you, I'm sure code, they're really not binding, but it matters more to some council members than it does to others, and often you affirmatively want to get their support, so. I wouldn't have written the charter that way, but so.
You're not alone.
Do we have any 501c3 organizations here? We do have a dedicated meeting for 501c3 on September 13th. Just so you know, feel free, of course, to attend that meeting. It's not, that's, the focus is on 501c3, but we'll also be discussing everything in our proposals and in the MLO. But we do, 501c3 is an area, is gonna be a focus, and do you have any thoughts on our proposed exemption, you know, how we're treating them, any thoughts on that? Especially those who have practiced for a long time.
I think I've been pretty vocal in mind that, I mean, a lot, lobbying is lobbying. If I'm with the Coalition to Save Something and I have, if people with my organization spend several hours to dozens of hours searching the background on something, if they, maybe they arrange transportation for supporters to go and speak on something, and if I'm a member of this organization and I'm, let's say I'm paid staff, if I'm going around and I'm meeting with council members or council member staff and department staff, I think most people would say that's lobbying. Now, if you're saying that it's not, it's you're differentiating group one because of what my message is, me as the lobbyist. I'll let the campaign attorney talk about the First Amendment issues there. Or you're segregating, again, based on who is delivering it, and you're creating some arbitrary reasons. Again, if even some organizations, I don't know what something like an HOA is. I've not had to work with HOAs on either side, but they seem to, in many cases, come out on various issues, and in some cases it is for the personal benefit of their members, either to oppose or support a project. So I'm not sure what their tax filing status is, but they're, you know, again, we're going to send out messages, contact your council member, do this. You know, it's when I, again, when I have gone, and it's this, working at CCA, and I literally would be following people on an issue with social or environmental justice groups, 501c3s, and maybe these fours or sixes, and they were doing the same thing I was, but I was reporting mine.
Yes,
we have some thoughts. Anytime you're really making a content-based determination that, you know, if your mission is to do the following, then you're exempt, but if your mission is to do something else that might also be tax exempt, then you do have to report, you're really going down that slippery slope. And back to fairness, you know, if the business, call it the business or the development community, is going to the trouble and hiring attorneys and hiring bookkeepers to comply, but then you have sort of the other side of the equation, whether it's the homeowners groups or labor union related group, and this I think came up in the minimum wage fight last year, 2 years ago, that it seemed that the folks on the increase the minimum wage side of the equation were not disclosing, whereas the employer groups were disclosing. So I think that's a slippery slope to make it content based. Now, whether it's based on, you know, kind of size of budget, what they can afford, or again, based on number of contacts, I think there's probably better ways to do that. So that's kind of our general comments.
Anyone else on that issue? We're an hour and a half in, so I wanted to, does anyone need a break by any chance, or? All right, good. Let me open it up again. Any other general thoughts? I don't know, Mark, David, any other questions we might have? Yes?
thank you, Brad Hertz, and just to kind of make sure that some of these issues get touched upon. One that is of significant concern is the private attorney general enforcement provision. We think that's kind of a recipe for abuse. I think it was mentioned at the last commission meeting, but we've seen abuse of that provision at the FPPC level. But basically, you know, any typo or blank box or any perceived violation could theoretically lead to a private lawsuit. Now, hopefully, if someone tendered the matter to the commission staff would take up those ones that were important and looked to be violations. But the commission staff is not going to be able to follow up on everything, and so presumably they'll deny a lot of those right of first refusal type requests, and that will make it right for a private attorney general to sue. You know, yes, there are protections in terms of anti-SLAPP, et cetera, but you know, unless we see a huge need for it, I don't think we need to extend it from the campaign context into the lobbying context.
I'd like to make a legal point on this. There is a cause of action for a party who believes the city has not carried out its law. It's called a writ of mandate to require you to carry out the law, encouraging people to have private suits so that they... Now, I'll tell you, the people who will be the private attorney generals are the people who are appearing and opposing projects and not registering and then settling for fees later. I mean, I just think it's ripe for abuse, and I don't really understand whether there's been... Do y'all feel like you guys haven't been carrying out the law?
Well, for those of you who are...
Wouldn't you give yourself an A on what you do? I'm being sincere. No, I'm being sincere.
I appreciate you. I think we're doing a great job. But let me say, let me ask, for those, there are other jurisdictions I have, I don't know what's off the top of my head, but there are other jurisdictions that do have these provisions. Have you seen any type of abuse in those jurisdictions or anything like that?
I haven't seen it used locally as much as statewide. And statewide, I mean, one could call it abuse, one could call it, you know, great, but someone went through and found hundreds of major donors who had not filed major donor reports and sued them all. And it, you know, tried to kind of get, depending on what side you're on, you could say, oh, it's a shakedown or it's a cheap shot. But it ended up that I believe there were a bunch of matters that were consolidated as complex litigation. I think it ended up that the commission stepped in and did streamlined enforcement with most of those defendants, but it was expensive to get extricated from that lawsuit. Locally, I haven't seen it. I believe there's a proposal in another city that just came out that would be, I think, even worse, one of the worst ideas I've heard, which is regardless of whether there's a private attorney general action, if you're a whistleblower and the commission agency takes the matter up, then you get 25% as a bounty or a finder's fee. And I think that would also be a bad idea. I don't want to suggest that this agency consider that, but another city is considering that. We're going to be opposing that on behalf of other clients. But I think, you know, just like we saw with nail salons or you know, it's a double-edged sword. Obviously, you want, let's say, ADA to be complied with, but do you want someone to go into every restaurant and say, I couldn't reach the paper towels and therefore pay me $30,000? You know, is that good public policy? So I think, you know, the commission, as far as I can tell, has a very aggressive and productive enforcement staff. The ability for whistleblowers and others to file complaints, and I don't see a lot of unprosecuted violations. Now, maybe they've never come to my attention because nobody knows about them. They're not hiring us to defend them. But you know, if you weren't as vigorous in pursuing matters as you are, then maybe you'd have to go to the public. But to me, I don't see the need for it.
Any other issues we haven't discussed that you want to raise, or any other comments you want to give, or anything?
I'll admit that I'm saying this so you can hear it.
Yes.
I really do urge you to look at these groups that oppose projects and then sue later for attorney's fees never, ever, ever wants registered. There are four or five people, almost everyone in this room can name all the unregistered law firms and lobbyists. It's an out-and-out abuse, and I don't know that it would call it shakedown, but most clients feel shakedown. At the end, these attorneys are paid $1,500, $250,000 to settle, and they never report anything. Letters, appearances of the commission, it's a big hole. Bigger, in my view, than the 501c3.
And just lastly, to touch upon a couple of other issues, the level of reporting that's now being contemplated, we think there's information that's really not, the benefit does not outweigh the burden. So the disclosing other expenses, when lobbying firms have to disclose other expenses, we think that, you know, again, takes a lot of time and effort. Is it really giving you the bang for your buck? Questions like contributions, political contributions being made, which are disclosable elsewhere online, both by the recipient and by the contributor, depending on the level of the contributor. Are we trying to kind of load too much information into these reports such that they're losing their value in addition to making them, you know, due so soon? So that really touches upon, in general, the concerns that our folks have.
Thank you. Anyone else? Any other comments? Input? All right. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. And again, we also will be presenting at the New York Conference this Saturday. We'll also have a discussion there. Next Wednesday, September 13th, at 10 a.m. in the room 1070 right here on the right. We're going to have another meeting again. Focuses on nonprofit, but we're going to have a discussion on all these wide ranging issues. So if you would feel free to attend there as well, you might hear some of my jokes repeated. So that's right. All right. Thanks, everyone.